Welcome to the City of Palo Alto's Veterans Day event. The Marines 23rd Regiment in San Bruno is for our Color Guard started our event this evening. Thank you to the Color Guard. We will now have Alicia Garcia from St. Samuel's Church of East Palo Alto singing the national anthem for us.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Thank you. Please be seated. And thank you to Alicia. Today, the City of Palo Alto recognizes and thanks the men and women of the United States Armed Forces veterans, active duty, National Guard, and reserve service members and their families from Palo Alto and from throughout the region for their service to our country and for their support for preserving our great democracy and its values. Veterans Day is officially observed on November 11th on the anniversary of the armistice that ended World War I, the armistice that began on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. However, Palo Alto last year, at the initiative of Janice and former Mayor Karen Holman, initiated this special event on the Monday before Veterans Day, and we're very pleased to have you all here. Our program highlights the men and women who are drawn from many generations and many backgrounds. Some charged across battlefields, others served on the high seas or the open skies. Others perform the many vital roles that make our armed services so strong. And they also represent the diversity of the backgrounds of our veterans and our citizenry. That is what we value so highly and what so many of our veterans have sacrificed to protect. I'd like now to ask the Palo Alto Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts to come up and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, along with Pastor Paul Baines, who will then lead us in the invocation. And I wanted to share what was pointed out to me earlier, that members of our armed services do not participate in the Pledge of Allegiance saying because they pledge their allegiance to the Constitution of the United States only. And so that was a learning experience for me. So can you come forward? How do we get them up here and visible? Okay. Great.
It is truly a privilege and an honor to do the invocation for so many great men and women that have served our country. I did not serve in any of the armed services, but I serve as a person of faith and a police chaplain. However, my father served in the Army, my brother was in the Marines, my uncle was in the Navy, so everyone got there but me. I guess I was a reject, I don't know. I'm going to pray out of my faith tradition and ask that you will pray out of yours as we go to the throne of grace. Gracious Father, we are ever so blessed, first of all, to be here. We are blessed to have known or have seen those who have gone on before us and served this country, some with their lives, others with their limbs, and with the sacrifice of their time. We thank you for those who have gone on before us, and we especially thank you for those who are with us now. We ask that you give them strength. You encourage their souls when they may even feel lonely. And that you guide them and lead them as they journey in this life. We ask all these things in the matchless name of your Son. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. Our cities benefit from veterans in another way. Public safety officers, the police, the fire, the offices of emergency services, utilities, and other departments are often beneficiaries of employees with the skills gained by serving in the military. It's the ability of veterans to work in teams, the capacity to adapt to challenging tasks and responsibilities, their attention to detail, and their drive to succeed, along with a host of other skills and training that makes transitioning service members and military veterans ideal for public service in police and fire departments and vital roles that continue to serve their communities. While veterans may come from different military occupational specialties, the skills acquired through service often complement the requirements needed to ensure a successful career in law enforcement or firefighting or other areas. I'd like to welcome our Fire Chief, Eric Nickel, who will represent the public safety departments here and share his thoughts. Chief.
Mayor Burt, council members, Lieutenant General, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of City Manager James Keene and the over 1,000 City of Palo Alto employees, I'm honored to be speaking to you today on such an important occasion. I appreciate the opportunity to share a few words on our collective behalf, and I'm especially humbled to honor our service members, including many city employees, and to remember their sacrifices that they have made, and the courage that it takes to defend honor, duty, and country. You know, one of the key leadership figures that we study at the United States Fire Service at the National Fire Academy, which is located just south of Emmitsburg, Pennsylvania, is a study of General Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain. He was a Union Civil War hero and recognized for his bravery at Gettysburg, where he was awarded the Medal of Honor. General Chamberlain said, "Heroism is latent in every soul, however humble or unknown. The veterans have renounced what they have renounced what are accounted pleasures and cheerfully undertaken all the self-denials, hardships, toils, dangers, sufferings, sickness, mutilations, lifelong hurts and losses, death itself, for some great good, dimly seen, but dearly held." We're here today to honor our heroes and to remember their achievements, their courage, and their dedication, and to say thank you for their sacrifices. I'm thinking of the heroes who join us today and those who are here only in spirit. I can't help but feel in awe of their service. We stand amid patriots and the family and friends and those who have nobly served. I honor and remember my own grandfather, who headed off to serve in the Navy in 1942, less than 6 months after my mother was born. I honor and remember my ancestors who fought with 149th Pennsylvania Regiment at Gettysburg. They were sharpshooters known as the 2nd Bucktail Regiment. And although he's not here today, I recognize one of my mentors, Major Jack Ruffer, United States Marine Corps, hoorah, Vietnam veteran and Silver Star recipient who guided me as a young man to serve my country, preferably in the Marine Corps, but always to serve my community. These are just a few of the hundreds of veterans who are city employees, friends, and family members. The service members we honor today come from all walks of life, but they shared fundamental qualities. They possessed courage, pride, determination, selflessness, dedication to duty, and integrity, all the qualities that all city employees try to model. Thank you for answering the call to duty. You've made our armed forces the most respected in the world. Our veterans didn't ask to leave their homes to fight on distant battlefields. Many didn't even volunteer. They didn't go to war because they wanted to fight. They were called to be part of something bigger than themselves. They were ordinary citizens who responded in extraordinary ways in extreme times. They rose to our nation's call because they wanted to protect a nation that has given them, us, so much. I think of my great uncle, Walter Emberg, every Veterans Day, who fought bravely in World War I and spent the rest of his life dealing with respiratory issues from the mustard gas he was exposed to on the Western Front. You know, the First World War ended 98 years ago on November 11th, 1918, and the legislation that created Veterans Day was, quote, dedicated to the cause of world peace and to be hereafter celebrated as, and known as Armistice Day. So we gather together in peace to remember, to honor, and to pay gratitude to those who have served our country. Our gathering is just one of many reverent observances and reinforces a sense of pride that burns across the nation today and every day. This is one small way we can honor those who've made the ultimate sacrifice so that we can live in freedom. So on behalf of all the city employees of the city of Palo Alto, we humbly thank you and honor your service and sacrifice. As your public employees, we are honored to serve and to protect you. And we know that we will never be able to repay the debt that we owe you. God bless you and your families. God bless our troops and God bless America. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. The Palo Alto Veterans Administration Hospital is one of the finest VAs in the United States, and we are fortunate to have them here with us. We're also honored in particular today that Tony Fitzgerald, the interim director of the VA, will share his thoughts about serving our veterans. Mr. Fitzgerald.
Wow, a lot of people in here. I hadn't turned back around since I sat down, I tell you. So, can I get a show of hands of the veterans in the room? You know what? Thank you for my freedom. Many days we really take stuff for granted in regards to just our everyday lives. You know, when we go to Starbucks, we go to Burger King, and we go to the library, and we come here. We didn't get here on our own. You know, we think about the gratitude, and we think about the dedication to this nation by the men and women who have served. I too am an Army veteran. I served 16 years, 2 months, and 5 days. And I was not counting. It was my mother that was counting. But you know, I have to say something. And I got to kind of tell you another story, and I promise you it won't take over the time that I'm allotted. So you know, I joined the Army Reserve first, then I was active, then I was a reservist. And I also played college football at Grambling State University. So my mother was, when I came home from in high school and said, I'm going to join the Army Reserve, my mother looked at me and said, why are you doing that? Because you're going to Grambling State University on a football scholarship. A lot of schools want you. You can go anywhere you want. Why are you joining the Army? And I really can't tell you why. I was a young man. I was 17 years old, and something came over me to join the Army Reserve. I said, you know what? I'm going to be the first player for Eddie Robinson to be a service member and a football player and a student all at one time. And I was that. So, and I wouldn't change it for nothing. I wouldn't change that for anything. And I used to put football up here with my greatest things when I was younger, to play for Eddie Robinson, and my military service was here. But once I became a little bit more mature and I understood really the value of raising my right hand and taking that oath to serve this country, I changed that around. I am proud of my time at Grambling, but I'm more proud of my time in the military. The VA has changed a lot. My father was a Big Red One member. He was a infantry in Vietnam. And my father would not come to the VA for any kind of care at all. I started working for the VA many years ago, and I finally talked him into trying the VA out in Chicago. And now I can't get him to take his hat off that I'm a veteran or to stop volunteering at the VA. But a lot has changed over the last century and a half. Today, VA provides benefits and services to 11 million of the 22 million living veterans that we have in this country. One of those receiving benefits, by the way, is the daughter of a Civil War soldier. Now, you got to do the math on that, right? But it is the truth. Today, we have over 350,000 employees serving veterans. A third of our people are veterans themselves. Today, we care for veterans at over 1,200 healthcare facilities, including 154 medical facilities in the United States and the Philippines, Guam, and also Hawaii, but that's the United States also. And we have over 1,000 outpatient sites of care. We're the largest integrated healthcare system in the United States, if not the world. So a lot has changed. But in spite of the passage of time, some things haven't changed. Still, we want VA to feel like home to our veterans. That's what my VA transformation is all about. We intend to be number one in customer service to our veterans because they deserve it. In the federal government, we want to be the best. You know, how many people in here got rich serving in the military, money-wise? Oh, I saw your hand go up, sir. But you know what, though? I'm sure you got rich here. I got rich in my heart by serving those who have served. And that's what I do every day at the VA. All my employees, we have 4,000 employees at the Palo Alto VA. We have 2,600 volunteers to help us meet our mission every day. And we have a $1 billion budget. So there's a billion reasons plus 4,000 other reasons why we've got to provide service and care to our veterans every day. I have I was with Secretary McDonald 2 weeks ago at our new clinic in Monterey. And I told Secretary McDonald, you know, I am so happy to be a VA employee and to be a veteran, I don't know what to do. It's, I don't know how to say it. I'm so happy, Mayor, that you're doing this and having this veteran event as a token of gratitude to our nation's heroes. I am not a war veteran, but I am a veteran. And I want to thank everybody for coming out today. I want to thank everybody for supporting veterans. And we couldn't do it without our community engagement. It takes more than just the VA and the federal government to heal a veteran, to house a veteran, to ensure that a veteran has their educational needs met and all their needs and their family needs are met. We need you to be active partners, and we appreciate that. You've been here for me, and you've been here for my veterans out here in the audience. And we got another 11 million that need assistance also. So thank you for what you do always and every day. Thank you again, Mayor, for having us here. And General, I really appreciate you being here also to support this. Three-star general, when I was in the military, I'd never stood in front of anybody with that much rank. So, well, you know what? As long as you don't make me do push-ups, I'm okay, sir. So thanks again, and we're here for you. If you want to see the price of freedom, come to our VA. It's there every day.
Now I've met a man who played for Eddie Robinson. So today, we are especially honored to have with us Lieutenant General Rex C. McMillan, the United States Marine Corps. General McMillan is a native Californian. He's commanding general of the Marine Forces Reserve and the commanding general of Marine Forces North. In this role, he leads the largest command of the Marine Corps, about 40,000 reservists who are spread across the United States. We welcome General McMillan to speak to us about his service and about the importance of honoring our vets. General?
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Well, good afternoon, everyone, and good afternoon to our veterans, family members of our veterans. Mayor Burke, thank you, sir, for inviting us here. Mayor Rutherford is here. Good to see you, ma'am, and nice to meet you. Good afternoon to the Palo Alto Veterans Association and our distinguished guests. Our Pearl Harbor survivor down here, good afternoon, sir. Good to see you. Good afternoon to our friends from the Royal Air Force. Thank you for coming, sir, the RAF, our closest allies, and the residents of Palo Alto, and a special welcome to our wounded warriors, those that are here this afternoon. Thank you for inviting me to be part of your celebration. It's an honor to be here on Veterans Day, especially during a year when the Marine Corps Reserve is celebrating our 100 years of faithful and dedicated service to our nation. Thank you. This year also marks the 90th anniversary of the Congressional Resolution officially recognizing the end of World War I and establishing an annual observance honoring veterans who served during that time. It became a national holiday in 1938, which we celebrate to this day. Given its roots in World War I, Veterans Day holds a special place in the hearts of reserve Marines. The Marine Corps Reserve was established 100 years ago when President Woodrow Wilson signed the Naval Appropriations Act of 1916 to provide combat-ready men to take the fight overseas. That act created a pool of dedicated, patriotic men and later women to answer the nation's call during that First World War. The Marine Corps Reserve has faithfully served in every conflict since then. From the trenches of Belleau Wood to the cliffs of Mount Suribachi on Iwo Jima, across the brutally cold terrain of the Chosin Reservoir to the jungles of Vietnam, through the Cold War, and to the blistering heat and cold of both Iraq and Afghanistan. Our Reserve Marines, including more than 3,300 who live and work in the San Francisco Bay Area, have answered our nation's call and will continue to do so. Today, it is all of our privileges to say thank you to all of our America's soldiers, sailors, airmen, Coast Guard men and women, and to our Marines, and to let them know a grateful nation appreciates their service and sacrifices. I had the honor of visiting the VA hospital here this afternoon. Thank you, Tony. They are a great organization accommodating a diverse veteran population while cultivating ongoing medical research and innovation to improve the lives of Americans' veterans. They're an inspiration. Veterans Day is a solemn day, and it's a day for reflection. It's a day for memories of loved ones going into harm's way for a greater cause. Of the 23 million veterans in the United States, nearly three quarters served during war or an official period of conflict. That's more than 17.5 million who have supported efforts to protect us and our way of life over the years. I'm proud to be here on this special day. Not only am I from the area, Middletown, California, but I'm proud also to be joined by so many great veterans like those here today and those who are no longer with us. One such area native veteran was Marine Corps Major Kurt Chuen Lee. Major Lee was born in San Francisco in 1926 and enlisted in the Marine Corps in 1944 when he was 18 years old. He was initially assigned to learn Japanese and serve as an interpreter. However, then Sergeant Lee had a strong desire that all Marines know. He wanted to serve in a combat role, which he did with honor. He earned his commission at the end of World War II and became the first non-white person to hold a regular commission in the United States Marine Corps. When the Korean War broke out in 1950, he was handpicked to command an untrained machine gun platoon because he had a strong reputation of creating battle-hardened Marines. Many of his colleagues would remember him as being the smallest man in the platoon, but by far the toughest among them. I previously mentioned the Battle of Chosin Reservoir in Korea. Chosin holds a special place in all Marines' hearts because of the overwhelming odds our men faced when they are engaged with a Chinese army 10 times the size of Marine forces. But they would need 10 times the manpower when they went up against Marines like Major Lee. As Major Lee's platoon was under ferocious attack by Chinese forces, he led his Marines as he shouted at the enemy in Mandarin to cause confusion. Major Lee was wounded twice in battle that day and sent to the medics. But as Marines know, being wounded doesn't mean it's time to give up the fight. He and another Marine quickly got back into it. With his arm in a sling, Major Lee led his machine gunners through a blizzard with temperatures plunging to 30 degrees below zero to assist another unit to hold a crucial pass and keep the Chinese army at bay. Even though he was outnumbered and wounded, he led 500 Marines, single file, through the most brutal winter conditions, guided by only a small compass. He was wounded again and finally put out of action, but his heroic actions are credited with helping save the lives of men of the 1st Marine Division. For his extraordinary heroism and grit under fire, Major Lee was awarded the Silver Star, the Navy Cross, and the Purple Heart. Reflecting back on that day before his passing in 2014, Major Lee simply said, "I was never afraid to die. I was adamant that my death, though, would be admirable." Ladies and gentlemen, that's why our nation honors the brave men and women who don our country's cloth. The special breed of Americans in the Army, Marine Corps, Navy, Air Force, and Coast Guard who are not afraid to die for their country and will always be held, that they will always hold in admiration both in life and in death. Such survivors are found here in the Northern California area. The 23rd Marine Regiment are the Marines among you who have participated in combat since World War II. They were instrumental in Kwajalein, Saipan, the Tinian Campaign, as well as the Battle for Iwo Jima. During the fierce fighting that occurred in the Pacific Theater, four Marines of the 23rd Marine Regiment were awarded the Medal of Honor for Valor. 23rd Marines also mobilized and participated in support of Operations Desert Shield and Desert Storm from December of 90 to 2001. Further elements of the 23rd Marines mobilized and participated in Operation Iraqi Freedom multiple times between 2003 and 2007. 23rd Marines also responded to assist in humanitarian relief efforts after the eruption of Mount Pinatubo in the Philippines in 91. They were again activated during Operation Enduring Freedom in 2005 in the Horn of Africa and also from 2010 to 12 in Bahrain in the United Arab Emirates. For their actions against enemy forces over the years, your local 23rd Marine Regiment received the Presidential Unit Citation Streamer with one Bronze Star, the Meritorious Unit Commendation, the American Campaign Streamer with four Bronze Stars, as well as the World War II Victory Streamer and the Global War on Terrorism Expeditionary Streamer, among others. But as veterans from all services will tell you, we don't do it for the recognition. We do it because we all have a deep, abiding love for this country. We will do whatever we can to preserve it from destruction by any enemy. Most veterans will go about their daily routine without ever giving thought about giving or getting thanks from anyone, which is why this holiday is so special. Personally, I can tell you that it means a lot when our nation expresses its gratitude for the service and sacrifice of those serving today and the millions who have gone before them. So now I'd like to thank the City of Palo Alto, the City of East Palo Alto, the Palo Alto Veterans Administration, and to all of you for your continued support to veterans. And finally, the Secretary of Defense has given us all marching orders. We would like to publicly recognize this year and thank all of our Vietnam veterans and our Vietnam veteran eras who were not treated well when they came home. We will never let that happen again. So on behalf of the Secretary of Defense to our Vietnam veterans, thank you for your service. And would you please rise, and if you cannot rise, please raise your hand and please hold them up as we have something special to give you here this afternoon. Would you please rise?
Well, thank you, General McMillan. It says a lot to our vets for you to have gone out of your way to be here today. I know they really appreciate it. So I'd now like to ask Councilmember Karen Holman to join me. She's our co-MC tonight. And by the way, Councilmember Holman, who was mayor last year, was the initiator of our Veterans Day here in Palo Alto, which is now an annual event. So we really look forward to doing this each year. And Councilmember Holman.
Thank you, and I couldn't be happier that this is happening this year, a second year, and that it's been deemed an annual event. Thank you, Mayor Burt. Thank you, Lieutenant General McMillan. Thank you for recognizing the Vietnam veterans especially. Mr. Fitzgerald, I'm still trying to figure out the Civil War daughter of the Civil War veteran. I'm still trying to figure that out, how that could be. Okay. But it does make me realize that I had never been to Alta Mesa Cemetery until a few years ago, and I went and discovered there is actually a Civil War cemetery at Alta Mesa. I encourage you to go visit, and because it was some time ago, it's sometimes not getting the attention that it deserves, but those are also veterans who have served. So go plant flags and honor those veterans as well. So on this Veterans Day event, we pay special and appropriate tribute to the women and men, I switched that around, to the women and men who put their lives on the line for their country, those who served in the armed forces of the United States. We salute them for their part in the preservation of freedom and honor them for the courage and devotion to our country. Today we have a number of veterans that each present a unique perspective on serving our country. And thank you again to Janice for helping pull these individuals together. As Mayor Burt mentioned, they are women and men, and multi-generational, representing several branches of the armed forces. They all have adapted to the challenges and responsibilities presented to them. They have demonstrated their loyalty, their devotion to their brothers and sisters in the arms and in their country. Our first speaker is someone I've had the privilege of knowing for a good while. Art Adams is a longtime Palo Alto resident, and I got to know Art around going around poking and hunting for this and that historical at garage sales and estate sales. And I've always found him to be a delightful man and did not start talking with him about his military service until we started doing these events last year and started thinking about that. So I'm delighted that Art Adams is our first speaker this evening. It's quite appropriate. So Art was drafted right out of high school and joined the Army in World War II. He was captured in Germany and spent the rest of the war in a prisoner of war camp. And before I ask Art to join me on stage, Janice is going to run a little clip for us to set the stage.
Your commentator is Lyle Vine. Swiftly exploiting successes, three American divisions smash into the battered heart of Cologne. Suddenly, the world is thrilled with the news of a startling achievement. A bold spearhead of Lieutenant General Courtney H. Hodges' First Army captures the Rhine Bridge at Remagen. A final mission of the great bombing fleet. All remaining key rail and communication centers are ripped to shreds. The great assault in force on the Rhine barrier comes with the crossing of the river by the British 2nd, Canadian 1st, and American 9th Armies. Winston Churchill insists on a personal invasion of Hitler's inner fortress. Now the airborne avalanche. Down upon the embattled Reich, 40,000 men leap to disrupt the German war machine in front of the great Allied Rhine bridgehead. One of the many prisoner of war camps overrun. An American officer shoots the lock off the gate, and the sight of Yank soldiers lifts the hearts of these captives.
Anybody who's of a certain age or watches old movies are familiar with newsreels, which that is. So another thank you to Janice for finding that. So I'd like you to welcome Art Adams as he comes up here and joins us on the stage. Art Adams.
I'm doing this, being Irish, I have trouble holding things within 10 minutes, so. We start, I know what day this is. You may think this is a joke. I assure you, it is not. These are words spoken by an Army major who had just inducted 1,000 of us into the United Army of the United States. The day was April 1st, 1944. I was sworn in on April Fool's Day. Big joke. Well, that time, I was 18 years old, Chicago kid. I was still riding buses in Chicago for half fare. That's what I looked like. They sent me down to Fort Hood, Texas, and went through 17 weeks of Army training as a replacement. And at the end of that, I was assigned to a division in Camp Pickett, Virginia, the 78th Infantry Division. And the reason they did that is rather than having sent 18-year-olds as a replacement, they put them all in a division and then sent the division across. The first, I left from Camp Kilmer, New Jersey, and then we spent about a month in England and the South Coast just training, and then we're sent over to Le Havre. Up until this time, everything I was going through was kind of an adventure. Really, a kid going through all types of exercise. But when the ship sailed into Le Havre, the wreckage of the war told me then, this is no drill. So that my whole attitude changed until that time. We were sent by truck and train up to a staging area in Belgium. This was in the fall of 1944. And in early December, we were sent online to replace the 28th Division that had been badly mauled. Our company was assigned to capture two small towns, maybe 50, 60 residents in each. The first was quite not straightforward. The second was not. It seemed like we had triggered half the German army at one time. So after 2 days, we were surrounded. The Germans had bypassed the town and come in behind us. So there were 38 left out of about 60. So we gave up. I'd been injured the day before by mortar fire and concrete and hit my legs. So now my serial number changed from 3696-1909 to Kriegsgefangen number I-9-6. So the uniforms were no longer green, they were all gray. So we transported by train. The first camp we were to go to was bombed accidentally by the British in the Christmas 1944. So we ended up in Hammelburg. In fact, the film shot shown here is the camp that I was in. And that showed the Serbian section next to the officers' compound that I was in. So we arrived there about the time, about 1,000 enlisted men. This was when the Battle of the Bulge broke. And the Germans had rounded up several thousand prisoners. And they had moved some 2,500 enlisted men into the camp, and then about 300 or 400 officers. when they established the camp for the officers, they wanted the Germans went in and wanted 40 enlisted men to run the camp. So we ran the officers' camp for the Germans. We operated the kitchen and cleaned latrines, all kinds of exciting things like that. Delivered food and firewood. And it was a good job. It was better than some of the enlisted men who were in the camps that were captured late in the war because they had very little reading material and it was just absolute boredom. So that went on fine. I worked in a hospital for a while. I was a hospital orderly in the officers' compound. I shoveled bomb wreckage, all exciting things. And then later on, in March, I escaped from camp. This was during a raid by General Patton. General Patton was criticized for this in March of 1944. He sent a column of infantry and tanks, some 300 men, 50 miles behind the line, supposedly to rescue some high-ranking officers. Out of the 1,100 officers we had five full colonels and 17 lieutenant colonels. But the raid was a failure because they grossly underestimated the strength of the Germans. When they broke into camp, we thought we were liberated. Men just scattered everywhere. But the Germans quickly rounded us up. I rode out with the camp, with the corps group, along with Captain Baum, who was the leader. And they moved out to an area where they reorganized to drain fuel into some surviving vehicles to make it run back to the front. But the Germans surrounded us. A couple of light tanks opened up, and then we were all sent back to prison camp again. So I was out about 5 o'clock in the evening, and I was back the next day at 7 a.m. But Patton was criticized for this raid because it was a very heavily armored area there. And to think of sending that many people back there, it was a disaster. Some 50 men were killed in that raid alone. And he was also criticized because his son-in-law, was Colonel John Waters, was in that camp. And he said he didn't know he was there, but there's indication that he did know he was in the camp. That was the reason he staged the raid. History will have to resolve that. Well, and this was in the end of March, about the first week in April, the camp was overrun. By this time, the Germans had marched out all of the ambulatory prisoners, enlisted men and officers, down to Regensburg, another camp. So they just left about 100 of us behind. And the injuries that I had received early on opened up during the time when the group was captured. So I was sent to a hospital in France, and after there for about a month, and was sent to one of the three replacement camps they have along the French coast. They named after cigarettes. There were Camp Philip Morris, Camel, and Lucky Strike. I was in Lucky Strike. To say that was when the war was over then. And then the convoy after the war, it took 25 days for us to go from Le Havre to New York. I think Columbus probably did it in a shorter time. But after a recuperation furlough in Chicago, I was sent to Camp Crowder, Missouri, to be trained, to join a division to be trained for the invasion of Japan, which I fortunately was not looking forward to. But fortunately, that didn't occur. And I ended up as a clerk in the stockade office in the military police. And all of that, looking back at some of the things that happened, some of the things I don't really believe myself that did occur, because I was only 18 years old. And at the VA has an annual meeting of former prisoners. And at one of the sessions there, I was chatting with another POW from Germany. And he said, "Are you glad you went through that?" Well, first, my first thought is, this guy's out of his mind. And then I thought about it, and I said, yeah, I am. I'm glad I did go through it, because it changed me from a nerdy kid into a reasonably adjusted adult. Now, would I like to do it again? I'd have to think about that a bit. So, but I took the advantage of the GI Bill, became an engineer, and had 40 years of engineering. So. And I really am fortunate for what I did, and I'm very happy I survived it. So, thank you.
One of the things I've always marveled about with Art is his memory, his remarkable memory, and his memory for details. It does also spark a thought, which is thanks to Art, who has written a book about his experiences that was prompted by other conversations and people like Tom Brokaw, who's recorded some of this. But whether it's war stories, prisoner of war stories, people's experience in the armed services, it is important to record these. They are precious stories that we need to get it recorded in one fashion or another. So thank you, Mr. Adams. So December 7, 1941 is a day that every American knows, and it's the date the U.S. naval base at Pearl Harbor on the island of Oahu, Hawaii was attacked that precipitated the entry of the United States into World War II. Our next speaker that was previously referenced was on the battleship Pennsylvania during the attack, remarkably enough. Mickey Ganich is a Pearl Harbor survivor. At 97 years old, he is eager to share his story. Technology has not left Mr. Ganich in its wake. Mr. Ganich has a PowerPoint presentation. And Janice will be helping. We'll be helping with that presentation while Mr. Ganich shares his story with us. I'm sure we all look forward greatly to hearing it. Mr. Ganich.
My name is Mickey Ganich. I was born 1919 in Magador, Ohio. Turn the next one there. Unrest situation throughout the world was getting pretty bad there in about 1939, 1934. Well, in the 30s itself, things were very hectic. I was born on a farm in northeastern Ohio. I came to California in 1939. I worked for WPA, working for Works Progress Administration, as one of the jobs that Franklin Delano Roosevelt created there and for the people during the Depression after the stock market crash. I joined the Navy January 21st, 1941, in Oakland, California. I went to boot camp in San Diego. They asked me what I'd like to do, and I said, I got some pretty good grades there, and they said, you have your choices. He said, what would you like? I says, well, I'm not mechanically minded. I'd like to do something that would not require any mechanical aptitude. So he said, how do you like to steer a ship? I said, that's great for me, because back there in Ohio, we didn't see anything big up close except ferry boats there. And then they said, that's for me. Went to boot camp, and they assigned me to the USS Pennsylvania. That's it right there. That's a battleship, Pennsylvania, 608 feet long, 33,000 ton. I reported on the ship August 15th, 1941. You really could call me a draft dodger, because the fall of 1940, any of the men 21 years and older had registered for that draft going into the Army. Now, some of the people I knew said, you go in the Army, maybe you'll be sleeping outside there, maybe get cold food. That wasn't for me there. I joined the Navy, so you can call me a draft dodger there. I went in the Navy. I reported on that ship. It says on big ships and stations, you have a lot of sports teams. And I was also active in sports, especially football. Report aboard August 15th, 1941. He says, what would you like to do? I says, I'd like to steer a ship there if I'm allowed to. They said he had signed me to the USS Pennsylvania. I'll be in the navigation department, one of the jobs is steering the ship. I said, that's for me. Now, the quartermaster's there, which I was trained to do, living compartments way back in the back part of the ship, back by the rudder. Well, Turn to the next one, please. This is the island of Oahu. USS Pennsylvania was assigned to Pearl Harbor itself. At that time, most of the ships in the Pacific Fleet were stationed at Pearl Harbor itself. Due to the unrest situation in the Pacific, Japan was getting very aggressive, taking over various parts of the Pacific. We put an embargo on Japan. We were not sending any supplies because up to that time, we've been sending iron, various things there that they needed. We figured to stop the aggression, we'd put an embargo, we would not send them anymore. That made Japan very, very unhappy. So they decided there they would take over the Hawaiian Islands. That way, we would give up. They would have all the freedom that they want in the Pacific. They decided there if they attacked Pearl Harbor, we would give up. Not all the Japanese was for that. A man by the name Admiral Yamamoto, the Japanese fleet, was against any aggression against the United States. He was trained, he was educated in the United States. He was against it, but he was outvoted. They decided they would attack Pearl Harbor, and that way the United States would give up. Now, we thought maybe there'd be problems with Japan, so we had all kinds of, turn the next one there. That's Pearl Harbor itself. In case there's any aggression from Japan, we decided we'd send all kinds of patrol planes to the west and northwest of Pearl Harbor in case there's any aggression from there. Now, USS Pennsylvania was a flagship of the fleet. Whenever we came in port, we tied up at a dock right in here, a 1010 dock, which is called 1010 dock because it is 1010 feet long. We always had an admiral aboard. Admiral liked to just walk off the ship whenever he wanted to go ashore. Rank has his privileges there. So whenever we came in port, we tied up at a dock. Some of these other people over in this area had to ride a boat for 15, 20 minutes to get to shore. We were the flagship of the fleet. Now, the normal procedure at that time was they'd have training during the week. On weekends, they'd be in port, have games, church services, anything, any activities. Japan knew what this was. Japan had maps just like this, you know, where every ship was. They decided there. Well, the United States decided there the only thing you have to worry about is sabotage. All airfields were instructed to bunch their planes all at once. Get them together, make it easy to prevent against sabotage. We made it really nice easy when they were attacked there. If you're all down, didn't have to worry about any torpedo planes, didn't have to worry about anything like that because the harbor itself is only dredged to 40 feet, which would accommodate any one of the ships, any one of the battleships. Our ship drew about 33 feet of water, so it's deep enough. So they figured they're safe against any kind of torpedo attacks they would have. Japan decided there that they would attack on Sunday morning when all the ships were in port. That wasn't so good, because we were scheduled, my ship itself was scheduled to play the USS Arizona for Fleet Football Championship that day, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, normally I said we were tied up at a dock, but we had propeller trouble, so they put us in a dry dock, which is right in this area, right in here, with a Cassin and a Downs, two destroyers in the same dry dock with us. I think most of you know what dry dock is. It puts you inside an enclosure, close the gate, pump out the water, that way you can work on the propellers, bottom of the ship or anything like that. Now, 2 days before that, we went in the dry dock. We weren't on a normal place. Japan decided there they would hit us on Sunday morning. About 5 minutes of eight, attack came. Now, Japan was smart. They came from the north and then dropped down to the south, so they were not detected itself. 5 minutes of eight, attack came. Now, We're scheduled to leave the ship at 8 o'clock that morning, scrimmage, get ready for that game with USS Arizona. We had all our padding on, get ready for the game. There was going to be, first attack was going to be against battleships. Over here's the USS Nevada, the Arizona, you have the West Virginia, the Tennessee, Oklahoma, Maryland, over here's the California, we're here. We figured no one would be out, really be out of their mind to attack us, because at that time, strength of the Navy were battleships. We had 8 battleships in port. There was no doubt, and no one would be crazy enough to attack us. But Japan figured they wipe out the battleships. They got the war won. You know, in your movies there, you wipe out the Indian chief there, then you got a good chance to win the war. So the first attack was going to be torpedo planes there, and they wipe them out, they got a good chance. Now, Admiral Yamamoto knew the depth of the water. Now, 40 feet of water is not deep enough for torpedoes, because torpedoes, when they're launched, they come way down and come back up, level off. 40 feet is not enough for that. So Admiral Yamamoto and the Japanese devised flotation devices on the torpedoes so they would not sink down so far. They're able to use the torpedoes in there. So the first attack was torpedoes. So all kinds of torpedoes were hit, all kinds of ships right in here. Go to the next attack. Next one, please. That's the USS Pennsylvania. Now, we weren't in a normal place. So the first attack here, they did not hit us. They would have hit us. In fact, we found out later that two Japanese planes were scheduled to hit the USS Pennsylvania because they were the flagship of the fleet and they were going to wipe them out. Well, we weren't in a normal place. So the second attack that hit us, a 500-pound bomb came right down there. Now, my battle station is up in the Crow's Nest, right up there. That's me, 1941. That's my battle station. Now, we had our football padding on. Get ready for that scrimmaging. Get ready for the game with the USS Arizona. So you didn't have time to change clothes. So up there I went, about 70 feet up in the air. That was my station. I was lookout. Now, the second attack is when they hit us with the 500-pound. Evidently, they got the report of the big ship in there. But 500-pound bomb missed me about 45 feet, came down here, exploded way down over in here. Shook me, but it didn't hurt me. It's kind of scary to see a big hole alongside of you. At the same time we get hit, go to the next one, please. That's the USS Pennsylvania. That's my ship right there. That's Arizona burning in the background. These are the two destroyers, the Cassin and the Downs, is the same dry dock with us. When we got hit, this destroyer got hit. It rolled over on this other destroyer. They said, flood the dry dock, flood the dry dock. Only bad thing about it, oil comes up top of the water, caught fire, and we had flames all around us. So oil and water do not mix there. That's the only hit that we got during that attack. The third attack was going to be aircraft carriers, oil farms, and repair facilities. Now, normally the aircraft carriers would be in port, but they were not. Admiral Halsey and his aircraft carrier group of the Enterprise in Lexington were taking planes to Midway and Wake Island. They were supposed to be in port, but they were not due to bad weather. They were late, about 12 hours coming back, so they were not in port. Now, Admiral Nagumo of the Japanese fleet here didn't know where our aircraft carriers were. If they were better leave, well, they could, and they left. That was really fortunate for us, because the third attack was going to be the aircraft carriers, the oil farms, and the repair facilities. Now, if they would have had a third attack, an attack to hit those places, I think that would have been a disaster. We would have lost the war, because the closest oil and closest repair facilities was 2,000 miles away. It would have been a disaster. That was the only hit that we got. The next day, Franklin Delano Roosevelt got Congress to declare war on Japan. We were attacked. Now, the country was united. We had kids going out there picking up oil, picking up tanks, picking up rubber, picking up metal, aluminum, anything for the war effort. Now, up to that time, the women were staying at home, took care of the house. and the men were out working. Now, we had blocks along people and enlisting in the service. All the men were going in the service. That left the women at home. The women stepped in, they started building planes, they started building ships, they building tanks, guns, everything. They were for the war effort. In fact, I had two sisters. One worked for Naval Supply Depot, one worked for Treasure Island. They all stepped in, they did the work. They furnished us with what we need. Nowadays, they work, but they don't get paid for it as much as the men do. I don't know how that's going to ever change, but as far as I'm concerned, I don't care what sex they are, what color they are, what you do the work, they should get the money. My ship was an old ship built in 1916. We do about 15 knots downhill with the tailwind. We didn't have the speed to keep up with the aircraft carriers and cruisers. They used us for fire support for the various invasions there. We started fighting back here. My ship was the invasion of Attu, Kiska, Macon, Kwajalein, and then we talked Pulusipan, Guam, and Philippines. All those various invasions there. For fire support itself, because we couldn't keep up with the aircraft carriers. The only invasion in the North Pacific my ship was that we missed was Iwo Jima and Okinawa. We're on our way back to get guns there, get ready for the invasion of Japan after we left the Philippines. Our guns would not shoot straight anymore after all those invasions there. We came back to Okinawa August 12th, 1945. But in the meantime, 3 days before that, they dropped an atomic bomb on Nagasaki. And 3 days before that one, they dropped an atomic bomb on Hiroshima. August 12th is when we got in 1945 at Okinawa, get ready. We already secured the island. 8:15 that night, Japanese plane came in with lights on, aimed its torpedo at the closest big ship. It saw go to the next one, please. Well, let's change that a little bit. That's USS Arizona after it got hit there. It's quite a blast here. And they lost 1,177 that particular day out of 1,500. Go to the next one, please. That's USS Oklahoma battleship. It rolled over in 20 minutes there. The reason it went over so quick because it was going to have a big inspection on Monday morning. So all the holes, all the places were opened up, getting ready for the inspection. It rolled over on its side. Those are people cutting holes in it, trying to get people out. I knew personally two of the people went out through portholes because it's small enough that they could go through portholes to get out there. Go to the next one, please. That's people picking up. In fact, I knew the person run that boat. The person he's picking up there, I knew them later. They're all gone now. Go to the next one, please. Okay, that's the women stepped in and did the work there for us to win the war. Really, they furnished us with what we needed. They said we can do it, and they did do it. My ship was torpedoed. August 12th, 1945, when this Japanese plane came with the lights on. Torpedo hit the propellers in the right-hand side, the starboard side of the ship. Everything went up in the living compartment of quartermasters. I had 26 quartermasters. I lost 20 of them that night. The next morning, the Japanese asked for peace. They towed us in the shallow ground in case we sunk. We wouldn't sink. Just sink in the mud. I was able to stay afloat while they signed the peace treaty in Tokyo Bay September 2nd. I talked to schools. I've been to clubs. It's been Japan many times. They were enemies once. Now they're good friends there. Two different times they chased me down the street there. I left my wallet in the store. I got my money back. My wallet in this country, maybe you get your wallet back. You probably wouldn't get your country. I get your money, but to me, they said, how can you even associate those people? I mean, to me, it's like a ball game. Your enemy's on the field, maybe you go out to supper together there. I think the biggest part of this country there, the kids are not taught to be accountable for their own action. They depend on their mother, father, then bail them out there. If they be responsible for their own action, if they got if they didn't do something wrong, learn by that mistake. Don't be afraid to make a mistake, because these kids are the future of our country. For better or for worse, it's the best country it is. If they don't like this country, I'll help them move to another. Thank you very much.
I'm glad I'm not the next speaker. No pressure. But we've been really privileged to hear these first two speakers. Gloria Bowen, since we are now speaking to the women, you could actually leave that up here for a moment, actually, was an Army sergeant and psychological operations specialist and translator in both Iraq and Afghanistan. She was one of the few women among, interesting story here, 3,000 U.S. troops. She shares her perspective on the challenges of American women serving in war zones. And Gloria is currently working for a Palo Alto company, Palantir. So Gloria, please welcome.
Thank you. And thank you, Art and Mickey. Those were incredible stories. It's certainly very hard to follow that. Obviously, we'll not be topping that, but I can tell a bit of a different story, too. So. And bear with me, I get a little nervous in front of crowds. So, All right. So I enlisted in the Army in 2005. And I served in Iraq as a psychological operations, or PSYOPS sergeant is what we called it at the time, with both the 82nd Airborne and 10th Mountain Divisions. I also spent 5 years on and off in Afghanistan, mostly with the US government, supporting the US military. So I come from a long line of veterans in almost every service, including a great uncle who was never seen again after getting captured in Vietnam. So service was something that was very, very important to me growing up. I always kind of knew I would do something related to the military, just wasn't sure what. I also enlisted on April 1st, and it took about 3 tries to convince my father that I had actually enlisted. But that was a fun conversation. But he eventually, you know, came around and was very, very proud of that service as well. So I now live and work in Palo Alto with my husband and 3-year-old son, and work at Palantir Technologies, which does a lot of work to make sure that our Marines, our airmen, our sailors, and our soldiers are safe when they're in combat zones. So when I came home, it became clear very quickly that not only did few people have a good understanding of what women in the military were accomplishing in today's conflicts, but they also didn't always understand how to ask about that experience. I've had people assume that my deployment was fun and that I never saw combat because I was a female. On the other hand, I've had people assume that I was treated very poorly by the locals or even by my fellow soldiers because of my gender. Neither of those are really accurate. And so, you know, when I had the opportunity to speak about my experiences as a female soldier, I jumped at the chance to help others understand, you know, that context through my own limited experience. It's hard to talk about how my experience differs as a female, mostly because for me and for many of the other women I served with, I was first and foremost a soldier, and that's how I thought of myself. I was different from my peers, but for me, a lot of those differences centered from the fact that we grew up in different areas, we had different tastes in movies or video games, which was pretty much what we spent our time doing when we were not on patrol and cleaning weapons and cleaning our gear. So. You know, we occasionally encountered others who had very strong opinions about women being in the military, others who were not thrilled or very vocal about not supporting that idea. I was fortunate in that the people that I spent my time with did not feel that way. And so when I ran into people like that, that tended to be, for me, the exception rather than the rule. That wasn't the case for a lot of female soldiers, but in my case, you know, I got pretty lucky and served with a really great group of people. Let's see. It's not to say that things weren't difficult for me because I was female. Sometimes it was a logistics difficulty. In very small bases, which we spent a lot of time on, we weren't always able to get separate female and male facilities. And I would have had a significantly harder time without the support of my male colleagues. They stood outside the door to the men's bathroom at 3 a.m., making sure nobody could go in so that I could take a shower. They gave up the relative comfort of their own beds so that they could sleep outside with me when there weren't any female bunks available, and I didn't want to sleep in the truck by myself because it was a little creepy. So that was really, really awesome of them. And the thing that was most important was, you know, aside from the logistics difficulties, they really, really made sure that I demanded and received the respect that I had earned through my own hard work and dedication to the mission. Ultimately, these people became a sort of extended family for me, and we really looked out for each other. Our deployment was also challenging enough that we didn't have a lot of time to make a big deal out of perceived differences and things like gender. War exposes you to the worst parts of humanity. You see filth, you see poverty, you see degradation. And when you get too much exposure to those things, it's really hard to remember that life is still capable of good things, of beautiful things, and of small miracles. The loss of life, like regardless of your gender, hits you just as hard, and it takes just as long a time to really process and recover from those experiences, regardless of whether you're a man or a woman. It's also really, really hard to rebuild your faith in humanity after years of watching it at its worst. But you have to really, really push yourself. You make a point to watch out for small things, and it's a long process, but it happens eventually. You see the like boundless joy of a kid playing with bubbles or running through the sprinklers on a sunny day. You watch the quiet dignity of a parent who sacrifices their own comfort for their children so that they can give them a better chance than they had themselves. You watch your fellow soldiers support and take care of each other, physically, financially, emotionally, because that's when you do when that you have a family. You protect one another. And for all of us, like, we were a family. You watch your peers come back from war, get over a lot of their own pains and their own struggles, and ultimately go on to support and serve their families, their communities, and in their own ways continue to serve their nation. And you realize just how much courage it takes to live an ordinary life. Working, healing others, and fighting in war zones is something that women have been doing since the formation of this nation. I feel very privileged. I feel very privileged that by the time I deployed, my doing so was fairly commonplace, and I feel very lucky and honored to have served with soldiers who treated me as an equal. I feel humbled by the more than a million women who walked that path before me. These women took on nearly every role available to them without complaint. When there was a need, they went into war zones without question, without rank and privilege, without pay, and despite the fact that they knew that they'd be criticized and ostracized by society, by members of their own families, and occasionally by their fellow soldiers. They did what they knew what was right because it was more important to them that they serve the nation that they loved, even if at the time that nation failed to acknowledge or truly value their efforts. This Veterans Day, I want to thank those female soldiers who served and fought in wars, but I also want to thank the male soldiers who accepted and supported us as we fought to make this a commonplace occurrence. They both had a huge impact on my experience as a female soldier, and it's the actions of both together that truly make me proud to be an American. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gloria. And I can't imagine the space you had to hold a perspective for people. So thank you so very much. We have had the privilege of a newsreel and a PowerPoint presentation, and now we're going to have a bit of a musical interlude. Our next guest is Vince West. And Vince is a Vietnam War veteran and shares his singing talents with us with his song, The American Flag. And this song is pending approval to be truly the national song for Flag Day. Welcome, Vince West.
So, my mother and father had two sons, 10 children. My oldest brother was drafted in 66, the next eldest was 67. Brother enlisted in 70, sister enlisted in 72, and I enlisted delayed entry in 1970. And my father's buried in San Manila, 1st Airborne, which is division from the Philippine Islands. Anyway, this song is in draft resolution. We're running behind, so I won't say more. One of the most emotional days, I've done this for 2 years, and one of the most emotional days in my life because of you, what your team has done. Give me this pen. I would ask if there are any more pens. I have four more siblings who need this pen. and maybe one for my mother, their mother. When I went in, I actually port called on my mother's birthday, December 17th. So of all the things that could happen, I left when she on her birthday. So this song is called American Flag, and I'm going to sing it for you. And I'm full of emotion, so I'm going to give it everything I can. But I've been crying back and forth here. I hope you enjoy it. The song is in draft resolution to officially become potentially the Flag Day song on our calendar. What I would say to that is what you're going to be listening to is the whole song, recorded in Nashville and mixed in California. And then you, to understand it, it would be probably just a single verse. I'm working with someone to make that possible, because you couldn't possibly sing this song as long as it is as a national song. So thank you so much for your time. I hope you enjoy it.
The national anthem I could hear, and I stood there proud for the red, white, and blue, knowing all of my life that I'd been true to the dreams we built as a country, and to the promises we've all made. Our soldiers still fight for freedom, and why American pride will never fade. You are the American flag, my tall and clear, as a national anthem is sung with cheer. I can hear all your people feel just like me, blooded righteous, strong and free. And as I watch your faces, I know in my mind, no matter where I look, I'll never find a country standing with me the way you do. I'll always be proud of your red, white, and blue. As we stand proud, sing our national anthem, sing it loud. As a nation free and strong, on my chest and say, America, I'll always give you my best. I pledge allegiance to the flag,
American flag,
of the United States of America,
American flag,
and to the republic for which it stands,
flag,
one nation under God, indivisible. God bless America. Thank you.
last year, a couple of days after this event, Eric Nichols said it was the best hour he'd spent in City Hall. What do you think, Eric? So we welcome now Dave Walker, who is a Vietnam War veteran. He was chaplain for the police departments of San Jose and Campbell, both. And he founded the Community Veterans Project, a local nonprofit created to support local veterans. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm honored to be here. I'm going to be brief, and I'm going to try not to make this all about me, because there's a feeling that I feel very strongly about, and I'll be brief about it. You know, World War II, Art, Mickey, nation's greatest generation. We've heard that a lot. I had something I wanted to add to that from a perspective, and I'll give you where I'm coming from. I did two tours in Vietnam, never anticipated doing that. I wanted to be a fleet sailor. Military had other ideas because I had a construction background. So right out of boot camp, I got orders to report to Marine Recruit Depot because they said, you deploy with Marines, you're going to train with Marines. I was like, oh no. Those guys run all the time. I didn't like to run. So anyway, I did my first tour in Vietnam. Towards the end of the tour, they came out to a fire base we're at. I was with 3rd Marine Amphibious. And they said, get your stuff. I'm cleaning it up for you here, but get your stuff. Hats up. We're going into Way. Well, Way was fun. So the night before, Dennis Fisher, a guy in my squad, had won a movie camera in a poker game. So he wanted us all to, you know, get the action. And so in there, if you ever happen to see this, we made it on DVD, you'll see a guy walking across screen with a guitar because we thought we were going to have fun loading up in the deuce and a half. We were walking in one of the biggest battles of the war. There were approximately 150 Marines. We walked in, there's over 10,000 the enemy. I don't have to tell you, it was tough, and it was tough going. We were not trained for urban warfare and really learned some hard lessons. I was with four of my buddies when they got killed during the battle, and tough way to come back. I went home, bunkered in for about 30 days, and sat there and watched my 12-year-old and 14-year-old brothers. And I thought, my God, if we don't end this war, they're going too. So I volunteered, I went back, Special Operations Community, and I went back to UDT 11. Down the Mekong Delta. That was another adventure that we don't have time to talk about today. But fast forward through my career, and at the time of 9/11, I went to Ground Zero. I was deployed back there. The events that happened there ended my career. Breathed too much stuff we shouldn't be in breathing. Psychologically, I think all the years, combat and other things I'd been in, I was no longer fit for duty, so I was retired out. So what do? You help other veterans. And that's what I want to talk about now. World War II, the greatest veterans, greatest generation. Current era veterans, do we have any here now? I know we do. Could you raise your hands and stand if you're able? Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to share a story with you. I started doing chaplain stuff, and I was on part of a team. We're taking severely wounded out of Iraq, Afghanistan. We were helping them to reunite with their families. And by the way, lady, IEDs hurt and kill a lot of people over in the sandbox. Who drove the trucks that drove that hit a lot of those IEDs? Women. So I recognize that. So we're working with both men and women who'd been severely injured. And you know what happened? Our team was to get them back with their families during one of the things, part of the transition. What did we say? We asked them a key question. Do you want a rehab to stay in or rehab to get out? And based on that, we would take a drought with their recuperation. There's one family, we have Dave and Sarah, the little baby Wyatt, who was always in his cami jammies, and I got to know the family pretty well, and we're joking about things. Dave's head looked like it had been split open this way. He was missing these fingers and part of his hand on the left side. Both legs were gone. He had other injuries on top of that you couldn't see. And so I was choking with him. One night we're having dinner, and I go, Dave, so where'd you get all this hardware? Oh, you have to go to a special place to get that. Oh, okay, cool. And I says, I got to ask you a question. It's part of my job. You want a rehab to stay in, rehab to get out? I'm thinking he wants to get out. He said, no, I want to stay in. Sarah, who we've been laughing and joking, was no longer laughing and joking. She was banging dishes and slamming stuff. I go, what's going on? Bad subject? He goes, real bad subject. We've been talking. I've been cleared. I'm going back to the sandbox. Are you serious? Yep. He said, I got a job for me. And I'm still, I said, I want to be in the fight, and I want to be with my men. I said, okay. Why do I tell the story? Because I heard that same thing over and over and over again. These, your generation, your people that didn't get in because it was easy, you got in because it was tough, and you want to be part of something that was really worthwhile. So the second greatest generation is living amongst us right now, and those is what I really wanted to dedicate this to. I thank you for your time. Appreciate you taking time to listen. Thank you.
Thank you for your support for the veterans who have served. And our final speaker today is Palo Alto Police Department Officer Brad Young. And it's known, I think, by people who are veterans that a lot of service workers, especially public safety officials, are veterans. So if you're a Palo Alto employee and you're a veteran, if you just stand real quickly so you can be recognized. Brad joined the United States Army in 2001 after graduating high school. He completed the 62-week Arabic language program at the Defense Language Institute Foreign Language Center in Monterey. After graduating the Army's Signals Intelligence Cryptologic Linguistic course, Brad was assigned to the 312th Military Intelligence Battalion, 1st Cavalry Division. In 2004, he deployed to Baghdad, Iraq, to support the first team during Operation Iraq Freedom II. He now teaches a Veterans Crisis Intervention Training Program for law enforcement in collaboration with the VA. Brad, thank you, and please join us.
That introduction knocks out about half my speech. Thank you for letting me speak tonight. My name is Brad Young, and I'm an officer for the Palo Alto Police Department. I was born and raised in rural America. About 2 weeks after my 18th birthday, a recruiter knocked on my door as I was leaving the house. By the end of a 20-minute conversation, I had enlisted into the United States Army. With dreams of traveling the world, endless adventure, and liberating the oppressed from tyranny and, well, oppression. My mother was thrilled, to say the least. I finished high school in May and shipped off for basic training in August of 2001. A month later, September 11th happened, and the Army utilized the open-ended contract I had signed and decided that I was going to be an Arabic linguist and do intel stuff for them. In 2004, February, I married the girl of my dreams. In March, I left for Baghdad with the 1st Cavalry Division. When it came time to transition out of the military in 2008, my bride told me, you should look into law enforcement. And it seemed like a very logical step. That's what brought me to Palo Alto. While serving the city of Palo Alto as a police officer, I've had the privilege of being on the crisis negotiations team. What that's done has opened my eyes to a very important role that we as law enforcement face today, and that's crisis resolution. Cops and soldiers, and I use that term generically, have many parallels, but there are gaping holes dividing the two cultures. I'm the only veteran on our CNT team, so I sought out training specifically for crisis intervention and crisis resolution within the veteran and military communities. I came up empty-handed. I was able to partner with the polytrauma unit at our local VA, and we came up with a curriculum to help law enforcement responding to veterans in crisis. What's important to understand is that the veteran and military communities have very unique experiences that make it difficult for non-veterans to understand. The purpose of this course was to give a little insight to non-veteran cops to better relate to and build rapport with these communities. Now, we know that the key to crisis resolution is to establish rapport and build on that until you can navigate that person out of crisis. Most active military and veterans are going to reach out to other military and veterans. But if we can teach a cop with no military experience some of the nuances of military culture, then they have a better opportunity to resolve that crisis that the veteran faces peacefully. And if we can get the word out that we're teaching our cops these de-escalation techniques and how to better serve the veteran community, hopefully they reach out to us in their time of need. Putting together something like this is not a small task, and it's one of the most important things I've ever got to be involved with. It's given me the opportunity to meet and talk with people all over the country, and we all have the same focus: reduce veteran suicide and get them plugged into the resources. In 2001 to 2003, I was in Monterey, California to learn Arabic. We had a girl that I was in my platoon, and she gave us a ride back to the barracks at the end of the day. She was a little bit further ahead in the class than we were, so she'd let us know what was in store for us. She graduated and deployed. In September of 2003, upon arriving to my next duty station in Texas, they informed us that she had killed herself in Iraq. So moving forward, that event has motivated me to do my part in doing what we can to lower the number of veteran suicides that we face, that the country faces today. Currently, the number of veterans killing themselves is approximately 22. Some will say more and some will say less. Either way, the number is 22 too many. Thankfully, there are nonprofit organizations trying to solve this problem and other problems that can lead to suicide. In San Francisco, Swords to Plowshares are housing the homeless veterans, getting them occupational training, and plugging them into a job field so they can provide for themselves again. A group out of North Carolina called Stop Soldier Suicide has been petitioning Congress for a reverse boot camp. It teaches soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines to reintegrate into civilian society and try to limit the amount of negative exposure that they have. Part of that, down in Malibu, there's an organization called Save a Warrior. They take veterans suffering from PTSD and they come alongside them in the healing process, and they teach them how to treat the injury versus living with the pain. There's a place in the Santa Cruz Mountains called Mount Hermon, and they offer a free week of camping for service members either deployed or coming back from a deployment that's 100% paid for meals and activities and an opportunity to reconnect with their family and find spiritual healing. As peculiar as it may sound, life in combat is easier than life at home. Your biggest concern is your mission, staying alive and the lives of your buddies, keeping everybody safe. At home, you have bills, mortgages, family issues, school functions, work, and the hardest thing of all, transition. Leaving the military causes a service member to disconnect from a camaraderie that was not found anywhere else. It also causes you to wake up without a sense of purpose or mission. You wake up and wonder, what do I do now? It's been an honor and a privilege to speak to you today, and frankly, everyone that stood before me on this platform is to share this stage with you is probably one of the greatest things I get to take home. It's my sincerest hope that we can rally together as a community in reducing the problems that our local veterans face on a daily basis. And if you're interested in these groups that I've mentioned, I'll be around afterwards. But let's have that conversation to see what we can do better as a community to serve those who have served our country. Thank you.
To help Americans everywhere, and especially those in this community, please go up to these veterans and thank them. Show your appreciation for their service and for their efforts on our behalf. Thank you for the wonderful work that you're doing. Two quick notes. Thank you, Gloria, for representing the women service members. Thank you so much for that. And I did indulge Lieutenant General. He said he'd be happy to stay behind, and the speakers have their photos taken with him, so I hope you'll take advantage of that. And Joel is here who can take care of that. And so I will now turn the podium back over to Mayor Burt. Thank you all.
Well, we hope you've all have enjoyed and appreciated this evening. It's our hope you'll leave tonight's event reflecting on the men and the women who have served our country, whether here at home or abroad. To our veterans here tonight, thank you to you and your families for your service. I also want to acknowledge a few people who have done an incredible job of helping put on this event. And we have from our community, Barbara Texeria, Jeannie Castellino, Peter Castellino, James Wadley, Todd Seeley, Zaria Betton, Sergeant Craig Lee, Carolyn Bissett, Stephanie Douglas, Adam Howard, Joel Dino, Roxanne Rutherford, Danica Brazil, and Simon Williams. And I want to again acknowledge East Palo Alto Mayor Donna Rutherford, who has joined us. As well as our city manager was here, our chief of police, Dennis Burns, and all the other senior members of our city staff who have come out to honor the veterans. And we also have some wonderful sponsors here. When we get done in a moment, we'll have refreshments out in the courtyard from our local Ada's Cafe and Piazza's and Krispy Kreme and Corner Bakery and Costco. So thanks to all those sponsors. And we will now retire the flags. We also have commemorative pins for everyone that we welcome you to come forward and all, everyone here to receive them, but especially the veterans. So thank you all for coming, and please join us in the courtyard.